the summit of Muswell Hill in 1874, the Alexandra Palace first opened its doors to the Victorians as a place of entertainment. Norton's reply to the Crystal Palace. But the 1930s found it often empty, a mere monument to Victorian extravagance. Few guessed then that this relic of the past had, in fact, a future. For at a workbench in Hastings, Scots inventor John Logie Baird was experimenting day and night in the mysteries of transmitting moving images by wire or wireless. In 1936, television was becoming a reality, and the BBC was made responsible for Britain's first public television service. Standing high above sea level and large enough to house all the elaborate apparatus, Alexandra Palace was a perfect headquarters for this new form of broadcasting. Armies of workmen made structural alterations both inside and out. Heavy cables and a great transmitter tower over 200 feet high was erected on the northeast end of the building, turning this former Victorian palace of fun into a landmark of significance in more senses than one. Apparatus of two different types was installed, that of Baird's own invention and the wholly electronic EMI system. Appointed as first director of the first television service in the world was Gerald Cock. Throughout 1935, closed-circuit tests and experiments were energetically carried out, with members of the technical staff acting as guinea pigs. By August of 1936, all was ready. The director of television was installed in his office. A small, hand-picked staff had taken up their posts. Here's one of the first three announcers, Elizabeth Cowell, being made up. BBC was ready to tell the world that the first television programmes were going on the air to Radio Olympia from Alexandra Palace. There was tension in the studio as last-minute checks were made of the complicated equipment. The second hand of the clock ticked up to the hour, and television had arrived.
Hello, Radio Olympia. This is direct television from the studios at Alexandra Palace. And to see and hear someone you know well, Miss Helen Mackay.
Elizabeth Cowell, myself, and Jasmine Bly were the announcers of those early days, and here is Jasmine to continue the story.
From November onwards, programs went on the air twice daily. Sometimes I announced dance bands. This one was Wilds, and it included a young guitar player called Eric Robinson. You'll see him in a minute, framed in the handle of the teapot. Cherko, the brilliant clown, over here from the Paris music halls, was one of the first visual comedians to appear on television. Sister of Lily Palmer, captured the hearts of a small band of early viewers with her Viennese songs. Entertainment was the order of the day, whether it be high-speed tap dancing like this, a refined form of Victorian burlesque, not so refined, but salty humour of the great George Robey.
Remember where you are, and temper your hilarity with a modicum of reserve. Have you heard this one?
The rhythmic singing of that delightful coloured artist, Nina May McKinney.
Let the dinner dishes go and follow, follow the crowd. Meet Harlem Dynamo, baby, baby. Leave the milk and butter out and hustle, just bustle along. So you can, over 6 foot two, who's the king of Lenox Avenue? Someone different with a something new, Papa Tree Top Tall. Now every gigolo goes around complaining times are slow, since the Harlem babies came to know Papa Tree Top Tall. Now every Pullman porter will tell you that his fame is known down in Bammy. Every brown skinned daughter wishes he'd be her own. Even Mammy in a thousand flats, who's the topic of a thousand chats and a thousand little families fed Papa Tree Top Tall.
But early television was not confined to light entertainment, and soon notable personalities began to appear on the home screens. Artist John Piper talked about painting.
All the time, the high percentage of so-called modern art that's always to be seen in London galleries nowadays. This is a painting, a landscape, by the English master Thomas Gainsborough from the Agnew collection. It's an example of Gainsborough's early work before he went to Bath and executed his famous portraits. And this is a masterpiece of another kind. It's a contemporary painting by a Spanish artist whose work, although he's over 50 and his reputation is enormous. His name is Picasso.
In a different field of art, Bruce Bairnsfather introduced to viewers his great hero of the 1418 war, Old Bill.
Old Bill's feeling a little bit like this. It's more or less a picture of a state of mind, this. I know the real words that Bill's saying, but I don't think I'd better say them here. Now, he's wearing one of these balaclava helmets. You know those woolen things that one pulled over the top of the head in those days? I think I ought to just tell you the story of Old Bill's balaclava. He was writing home to his wife, Maggie, and in one of his letters he said, "Will you please thank the parson's daughter for the pair of socks me? One I'm using as a balaclava helmet and the other to keep my change of clothes in."
David Seth Smith, forerunner of the post-war George Cansdale, brought live animals to the studio.
Chimpanzee. More so than the majority of them, they're all intelligent. And as you probably know, the chimpanzees are the nearest relations to the human race.
And the then Minister of Transport, Leslie Haubalisha, longed to speak about road safety.
Misery, misery, and pain. I appeal to all those who use the roads to remember to use them in such a spirit that accidents will be avoided.
Soon programs began to take on a definite pattern, and the Sunday night play was established.
Fade in camera three.
One of the earliest of these productions was Sheridan's School for Scandal.
Charles, give me your hand.
I don't think ne'er so ill of you as I did. What I have heard has given me great satisfaction.
Gentlemen, I beg pardon. I must wait on you downstairs. I will send this man away and return to you directly. Sir Peter.
Not a word of the little French milliner.
I?
Not for the world.
Ah, Charles, if you associated more with your brother, one might indeed hope for you. He is a man of sentiment.
Sure. He's too moral by half.
No, no, come, come, you wrong him.
Hang him. He's a very anchorite. A young hermit.
Okay, you must not abuse him. He may chance to hear of it again, I promise you.
Why, you won't tell him.
No, but, Harkey, have you a mind to have a good laugh at Joseph?
I should like it of all things.
Then, he had a girl with him when I called.
Joseph? You jest.
Shh. Pinch milliner. And the best of the jest is, she's in the room now.
The devil she is.
Shh, I tell you.
Behind the screen. Light, get something.
No, no, he's coming. You shan't indeed. Joseph will never forgive me. Odds, here he is.
Lady Teazle. By all that's wonderful.
Lady Teazle. By all that's horrible.
Lady Teazle. By all that's damnable.
Orchestral music programs came into vogue, and a full-scale television orchestra was formed under the able direction of the late Hyam Greenbaum. Television's ability to broadcast the visual art of ballet was quickly recognized, and a little-known ballerina from Sadler's Wells, Margot Fontaine, graced a now increasing number of private TV screens with her exquisite dancing. And before long, a full company came up from Sadler's Wells, complete with scenery, costumes, and Frederick Ashton, to give before the cameras their ever-popular romp, Facade. The first magazine-style program to gain wide popularity was Picture Page, in which Joan Miller, at a dummy switchboard, plugged into a considerable range of topical personalities.
You're looking at Type Major Massey, the bagpipes man from Trafalgar Square. Leone, the vagabond violinist. Harry, a muffin man. You're looking at Colonel Hughes, DSO, OBE, showing helmets of the British Cavalry Regiment. You're looking at Oliver Oldfield, who cleans London statues. The pearly king and queen of Blackfriars, Mr. and Mrs. Tinsley. Sergeant Major Lynch of the Royal Hospital Chelsea, with two Chelsea pensioners. Josh Cairn, a London street musician. The racecourse character, Prince Modelulu. You're looking at dancers from the English Folk Dance and Song Society.
And the studio cameras went out into the palace grounds, me with them, for local outside broadcasts.
On this occasion is C.A. Whitcomb, who, as most of you know, captained the English Ryder Cup team last year, 1936. He's going to demonstrate various shots, and he's going to start off with a drive. Well, perhaps you'd like to drive for us so that we can see just how far it goes. I know it goes a long way. A beauty.
We end our adventure of televising the coronation. Magnificent Greys drawing on that almost unbelievable state coach with their majesties, the King and Queen.
Stadium. here still, and nobody in the world knows who will be. An hour or just a few seconds? Start.
45 seconds again.
They're measuring up to each other and booms after him again. He's driving him back on the rope for those vicious left and right. And there goes Danaher, cracking off the camera. Richard is taking a short rest while the referee counts, but he's up on six, and that's too soon. And then he goes flat on his back again. Danaher's rarely in trouble this time. It looks as if he'll beat the count. Yes, look, he's on his feet at nine. He's looking very dazed. He'll only need one more punch like the last to finish the fight. Danaher is completely exhausted.
10 seconds to go.
But he doesn't look like doing it, though. This must be the end. No, it isn't. He's getting up for more. Yes, he's up for time in this round. And he's certainly showing terrific punch. And there's the bell for the end of the round. Comes to the 14th round and Boone's measuring up for the kill, and there it is! Terrific right to the door. Danaher's down once again, and it must be the end this time. The referee's counting into Danaher's ear. It looks as if he's trying to get up again. Yes, he's up on nine, but no, the referee's stopped fight.
Few broadcasts were, or are, more popular than our visits to the London Theatre. The first musical comedy which we televised was a...
Disturbed, President Roosevelt talks of peace.
I have seen war. I have seen war on land and sea. I have seen...
The hospitals are full of wounded. Madame Azana has been killed by Spanish warships. Heavy damage was done, but the
things badly damaged.
The rebel forces.
Hate war.
Congratulations, Mickey Mouse. Congratulations to you. Congratulations. Your picture show was fine. It's a hit. It's a hit. And we want to shake your hand. Congratulations. Happy days to you. You sure brought down the house. And we hope you have a lot of success. Congratulations, Mickey Mouse.
You're wonderful. Wonderful. Marvelous. I think I kiss you now.
But the war had its after effects, and in the severe winter of 1947, it was a fuel crisis that closed down the television service. But of course, new and more compact outside broadcast vans set out to capture, for example, the thrills of the cinder track.
Here come the riders. Seven on the inside, Johnson of New Cross. Next to him, Martin Craven for West Ham. In number three position, Ray Moore of New Cross. And on the extreme outside, Frank Bettis, the other West Ham rider. Moving up to the tapes. And Johnson. Johnson for New Cross just gone into the lead in front of Craven of West Ham. Moore of New Cross and Bettis of West Ham fighting out there. Great tussle around this first bend. Now they head down the far side. It's Johnson. Johnson well out in front of Craven. Moore in third position for New Cross and Bettis of West Ham last. This looks like a 14th victory for New Cross as Johnson streaks away from the lead there. There he is looking close up. A grand view of this great New Cross rider. Johnson, captain of the Australian team, well out there in front of Craven for West Ham. Moore, New Cross third and Bettis West Ham last. It's rather like Monday's washing on the line now. They're strung right out. Now they're coming up towards the finish. Only about half a lap to go, and it's still John Given, Moore and Bettis. I don't think there's any change in the order as they come up to the finishing line. Johnson first, Craven West Ham second, Moore third for New Cross, and Frank Bettis a rather bad last for West Ham.
In summer, television revisited the zoo.
And as the years rolled by, you could sit in your armchair at home and watch Dennis Compton batting at Lord's, tennis at Wimbledon. The favorite crash. Sport was back in a big way. And so was traditional ceremony. With events in the United Kingdom, the planners arranged a cross-channel television broadcast, and through the matchless skill of British technicians, people in their homes in this country saw and heard in 1950 these citizens of Calais and the crowds milling about in front of the Hotel de Ville.
And this time to the platform. The platform with its little tiny pots of begonias in a row all along the front of it.
By now, the number of television sets was increasing by leaps. And a large television public existed with its favorite personalities and performers. We instituted the television garden party and played host to scores of people who were beginning to regard us as their friends.
And just before we go to that horse I was talking about, we thought we'd pause one second to look at the great crowd watching the variety show that's going on in the open air on this very lovely afternoon. And there, take one last look at all of yourselves watching the fun, and then join me while I go and have a try at this horse. As you'll observe, it's not quite the horse we thought it was. Mr. Hearn, sir, come and join me on this horse. Thank goodness I've got a riding partner. You go first, Richard. Yeah. Just ride up. That's right, it's easy. Dead easy. Right, now, if I can hand over this microphone to someone, I'm going to try. You two can win £1,000,
With its ability to project film into people's homes, television was not a spectacle of the blowing up of Heligoland was seen in every television home. The 1948 Olympic Games were the occasion of one of television's classic outside broadcasts, and throughout the event, reports on film appeared in television newsreels. But before the Olympic Games, both outside broadcasts and films
cooperated in televising the wedding at Westminster Abbey of Princess Elizabeth and the Duke of Edinburgh. Six years later, at the coronation of Queen Elizabeth, the main role of Alexandra Palace was to record and edit the outside broadcast and to fly copies of these television systems. The films were flown by helicopter to London Airport and then by jet bombers to North America for transmission the same day.
At the beginning of 1948, television formed its own newsreel unit, which was based at Alexandra Palace until January of this year. Amid the sunshine of Florida was fought out last week America's annual motorboat steeplechase. Americans call it a waterborne version of the Grand National and say it's hard to beat for speed, splash and spills. And the outboard jockeys come in for a generous helping of all three. Coming up to the land jump, Florida's equivalent of Aintree's water jump, the little boats set out to tackle the trickiest part of their 12-mile course, the plain fence and the open ditch. But the outboard seem to be able to take it all in their stride, whether they're waterborne or airborne. And whichever way they're going, in the words of the American commentator, it's once again still anybody's race. Shooting home to a dry land finish comes Dick Pope Jr. and his Scrap Lightning of America's outboard steeplechase.
And not forgetting the all-important younger generation, we instituted a children's newsreel. From the very beginning, the accent was on animals.
To Brumus, the most famous little bear in the world, falls the honor of opening the very first children's television newsreel. And while she's bowing to the crowds who've been flocking to the zoo in Regent's Park, London to see her antics, I think perhaps I'd better tell you who we are. My name, of course, is Mary Malcolm, and later you'll be hearing the voice of Stephen Grenfell. All these pictures were taken to go, when Brumus's keeper could pick up the lively little bundle of white fur, long before some of you saw her during the recent programs from the zoo. As you will see later, she's quite a big girl today, with, I'm going to whisper to you, rather a bad temper. So many people went to see Brumus that the crowds are marshaled by loudspeaker in a sort of one-way passage, and the poor keepers at Regent's Park...
Thinks of Danish exports.
BBC war correspondent Edward Ward introduced a form of travelogue.
I was surprised in Denmark not so long ago to find that the Danish bacon ration is no larger than ours, and our butter ration is actually smaller. Still, in spite of this, life has a very pleasant flavor in Denmark's capital, Copenhagen. The city lies between the sea and a cluster of lakes. Its name means merchant's port. In addition to the traffic of the many waterways, there's plenty going on in the busy city streets. And in the middle of it all stands the city hall. Up to fairly recently, you wouldn't have seen so many clothes in the shops. But now there are plenty. And their women's clothes are just a bit cheaper than they are here in England, from what I could see. Men's clothes are quite reasonable, too. And there's a brisk trade in bathing costumes.
And soon, a foreign, a more political nature turned a young politician, Christopher Mayhew, into an overnight television personality.
The towns. They provide the vast bulk of the urban population. Four-fifths of Singapore, where George Rutner took most of these street scenes. some of the Chinese cling to their own way of life. They are loyal to China rather than to Malaya. But many want to develop a Malayan nationality. Shops, houses, streets are crowded. The Chinese population is increasing still more rapidly than the Malay. There's a busy look, too, about these Chinese districts. The Chinese have more drive and business sense than the Malays, and they pretty well monopolize the best jobs in commerce and industry. These shops and stalls and business houses typify the Chinese economic stranglehold.
Combining film once more with Lama, the documentary program showed viewers many aspects of our national life, such as the internal running of a large London hospital. In lighter vein, the feature known as London Town invited us to explore our capital city with Richard Dimbleby. We visited the Horse Guards, the London Stock Exchange, and we climbed up inside Big Ben.
We sat and watched in safety while the dauntless Dimbleby wrestled with a skidding bus.
And as if that wasn't enough, the next idea was to get me to take a fire engine.
Television star was made of three-ply wood and felt, and through him, Annette Mills reached the hearts of countless children and grown-ups.
He simply cannot fail. Thieves, beware. Dick Muffin waves his tail. He rounds them up and he tracks them down, follows them round and round the town, wearing a most important crown. Muffins on the trail, bravo.
The actor-playwright Peter Ustinov, an accomplished raconteur, amused a million families with an anecdote.
This invasion alarm happened. I rushed down to the pillbox. The whole of France seemed to be alight. There was an aerial bombardment going on the other side. There were MTBs going across the channel. There were searchlights sweeping across it. There were big guns firing from the railways across the channel. The whole thing looked like a children's drawing of a battle scene. It was as simplified as that. And I got to the pillbox, and the Berkshire farmer was laughing, as it was his wont. He said, I don't credit it, you know. I think, of course, I don't believe it. It's serious, you know. I can't apply my mind to it, you know. And the little Jew was saying,
"Was ist los, dass du so Lärm machst?"
So eventually, we had a very strange officer with a red moustache, rather plump man, who came around, pulled the Hessian curtains aside, and he was in pyjamas, but with all his equipment over the pyjamas. And lanyards and whistles and a revolver connected with a green string. And he looked at us and said,
"I can now reveal to you that we are a suicide battalion. There are massed motor brigades inland, trained on the beach. Some of those bombs are bound to fall short. Good luck, good luck, good luck."
Yes,
It's nearly 18 years since this song, sung here by Adele Dixon, first proclaimed, "Television is here."
Magic rays is all about us in the blue, and in sight and sound they trace living pictures out of space to bring a new wonder to you. The busy world before you is unfurled, it comes, its tears and laughter too. One by one they play their part in this latest of the art to bring new enchantment to you.
Now it's 1954, and Alexandra Palace, the mother of television, looks back once more over her past. For her children are growing up, her offspring of high-power regional transmitters, Sutton Coldfield, Home Moss, Kirkashots, and Wenvoe. Already, the post-war studios at Lime Grove, Shepherd's Bush, are being superseded by the vast new television centre at the White City. So, Alexandra Palace, where British television was born and grew up, retires from the fray with dignity and many happy memories of pioneering days. Though the transmitter remains for the time being in its empty dressing rooms and studios, only the echo will be heard of an exciting era in our history. Thank you, Palace.